Good morning. My name is Charles Symes, and I'm the CEO founder of Allegra Home Care. And this morning, I'm pleased to introduce the next speaker, Stephanie Bonnegut. Stephanie is a family care specialist with the Alzheimer's Association Northern California and Northern Nevada chapter. She provides education, consultation to family caregivers, provides resource referrals on the helpline, presents educational workshops to the community, and facilitates support groups for people in the early stage of Alzheimer's disease and caregivers. Stephanie is the lead on the San Francisco Dementia Safety Net Program, a program to connect people living alone with dementia to needed programs and services. She has been with the Alzheimer's Association for over 5 years. Previously, Stephanie worked as a social worker at the North Shore Center in Seattle, Washington, where she supported family caregivers, provided depression counseling, and facilitated support groups. She was also a social worker at a skilled nursing facility. Stephanie is an LCSW and MSW from the University of Washington and a bachelor's degree in physiology from UC Santa Barbara. And now, please welcome Stephanie Bonnegut.
Let me get settled here. So this is totally cool. So I've been with the association for about 6 years, almost 6 years, and I think this conference has like doubled or tripled in those years. This is really cool. So I'm here to tell you, I gotta get used to looking down here, about a couple programs that our chapter of the association's been working on for the last couple years, and we affectionately call them the Leave Me Alone Projects, the Live Alone Projects. I'll see if my finger works. Where do I point it, Tom? Oh, there we go. So this is our agenda today, so I have not gotten used to progressives. We're ditching those. We're going to talk about three Live Alone projects that we've been working on at our chapter for the last couple of years. And these programs were really developed to address the needs of people living alone in the community with Alzheimer's disease or another related dementia. So I'll tell you about three programs that we've done. And then I'm going to talk to you about kind of the major outcome of the program. And it's what we call the Live Alone algorithm. And I'll tell you how we developed it, and I'll show you how to use it. We'll walk a client through it, so you can go back to your agencies, organizations, and use it. And then I'll tell you about some other tools that you can use that we developed. Next slide, thank you. So you may already be familiar with some of these statistics, but a third of the people who live in the community with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia live alone. That's a huge number. So if you picture an 83-year-old woman, maybe she was widowed, maybe she was never married or partnered, she's probably not diagnosed and most likely lower income. She's probably getting by with her ADLs, so she may look pretty decently dressed and decently clean, but she's having trouble with IADLs, you know, maybe transportation or medication management. Managing her money, that's a huge one. So that's what our typical live alone looks like. And I can tell you of the 20 clients I've worked with, I have two that fit this profile exactly. Next slide, please. So just like most elders and most people who we wanna stay in our homes and we wanna live in the community for the most of our lives. So the same thing with our folks living with dementia. But this dementia causes issues with unmet needs and greater risks. So our folks living alone have unmet needs such as the proper medication management, so, you know, especially if they have multiple medications trying to manage that. They might not get their hearing and eyesight checked as regularly as they should. They likely have poor management of behavioral health issues, and they definitely lack companionship or activities. So these folks are also at a lot of higher risk for malnutrition, for falling, for getting lost when they're outside of their house or apartment, and self-neglect. and they are very much at risk for financial exploitation. So these folks really fall through the cracks, and a lot of times, the first time we see them is in some sort of medical crisis. So with this in mind, we develop these Leave Me Alone, Live Alone projects. So I'll go into more detail into the three projects in a second, but we got funding through Administration for Community Living grant and Measure K tax funds in San Mateo County to develop these programs to identify and assist these people living alone in the community with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia. So as I mentioned, two were funded by the Administration on Community Living, and we partnered, our chapter partnered with Alzheimer's Greater Los Angeles to do two of these projects. And then there's, thank you. And then there's San Mateo Measure K tax funds is funding the project that we're doing in San Mateo County. So all three programs, they're slightly different models. So we looked at partnering with community organizations, low-income housing, and then in San Mateo County, there's many partners, but the big change there is we have this advisory council that we created. So again, the goals of all the programs were to develop, deliver, and enhance services to people living alone with dementia in the community. There we go. So the first one I'm going to talk to you about is one that I've been doing for the last couple of years. We call it our community partner model, and we titled it the San Francisco Dementia Safety Net. So we started this in San Francisco because San Francisco actually has a higher than national average of people living alone, seniors, elders living alone. And therefore, we translated into higher numbers of people living alone with dementia in the community. And we had partners again on this grant from Alzheimer's Greater Los Angeles. So they started their program a couple months after we did. They did it in LA. We started it, and then they followed suit. So we what we first did was we invited a whole bunch of service agencies to a meeting to see who would be interested in playing with us. And we got three partners out of that. We got San Francisco Village. So if people know the Village Network, it's a membership organization that helps people age in place in their homes. We also partnered with Little Brothers Friends of the Elderly, which is a friendly visiting program in San Francisco. And we also partnered with Open House, which is an LGBT senior service agency. So one of the first things we did is we offered education on dementia to the staff of these partners, to the volunteers, because they're all very volunteer-heavy organizations, and to the clients and members of the partner organizations. So we decided to do a two-pronged service approach. We decided to do some case management by the staff of the Alzheimer's Association. So myself and two colleagues have been doing that. And our goal was really to connect the client to whatever services they wanted and needed, and then hopefully get them hooked in with some sort of long-term case management, either private or county run. In San Francisco, the MSSP program, which is for low-income folks, there's sometimes like a 4 to 6 4 to 6 month wait list for folks to get into that program. The other thing that we wanted to do is we wanted to develop support systems for these folks. They're living alone. They're going to need long-term support. So we decided we would call these care circles, and we wanted to develop care circles for them. And the care circles came from the LGBT community, who don't necessarily have family of origin involved. So we just wanted, we wanted care circles made up of family, of friends, of neighbors, and maybe even professional organizations. And then to part of the grant was to create this algorithm, which we're talking about probably the last half of my talk, and then a resource guide. And the resource guide is a list of community agencies and organizations that can help these folks, and also a bunch of tips on how the support systems can help these folks. So our partners, the three partners that we had, helped us identify potential clients. And they did this a couple ways. They proactively thought about people that might have shown signs of dementia or show signs of dementia because we gave them that training. Maybe those clients or members had actually also expressed that they had some concerns about their cognition or their memory. And then in some cases, especially open house through their case management, they knew that these clients had a diagnosis of dementia. So I would work with the partners to assess the needs of the folks. We would go in, usually the first couple meetings, we would go in together and talk to the person. And then we would connect them with support services and systems, and we would try to assist with some long-term care planning. And that we hoped with this working together, we could enhance their access to community resources, reduce their isolation, improve their quality of life, and increase the awareness and capacity of those partner organizations to work with the folks with dementia. So our goal was to work with 20 clients, 10 for the second 2 years of the grant. And again, the model was case management. And we did say it was time limited. We did about up to 6 home visits in a 6 to 12 month period. We were trying to be this bridge between long-term case management. We did do it in person, and we also provided telephone support. And if folks needed support past the 12 months, we could offer that too. And then we did the care circle development. So we would work with the clients to try to identify somebody. Maybe there's a long-distance family member, but maybe there's a neighbor or friend close by that can help out. And again, a lot of times it was professional agencies. A number of times, a number of my clients had APS caseworkers or MSSP caseworkers, but they wanted us to come in and help us with the dementia piece of the case management. And there too, with the care circle, we wanted to get them together and we wanted to provide education to them so that they knew what their role would be going forward supporting this person. So we are available to them in person and by telephone, and much like with the folks that we enrolled, we would be available after the 12-month time. So we created a needs assessment tool to assess the folks' needs, and we assessed cognition, we assessed functional ability in the home, emotions, home safety, and then for care circle development, we used what's called the Lubbin Social Network Scale to try to help identify that care circle. So since this is a funded grant, we had some evaluation tools we're going to use, and we have UCSF researchers who will be evaluating the data. And we're using the Quality of Life Alzheimer's Disease. It's a 13 question self-rating that the person with dementia would do, and it rates things like from a scale of fair to excellent, money, quality, family, friends. And so that was something that they filled out at the beginning and the end of the program. And then we also used the CANE, the Camberwell Assessment of Needs for the Elderly, and that's a 17 category rating of met and unmet needs. And we again did that before and after, and the researchers will be looking at that. So these are the outcomes of the program. We had 20 clients enrolled. We hit our numbers. We got 40 referrals. So we were batting 500. So it took a lot to get folks involved. 20 of those referrals came from our 3 partners, and 20 came from 7 additional agencies that we had done some outreach to. So we did trainings for the partner agencies and their membership. So we did our program called the 10 Know the 10 Warning Signs for the partner agencies, and a lot of times we did that for members and clients of the agencies. And then we did some additional training for the volunteers of the partner agencies, anything from our basics of Alzheimer's disease presentation all the way up to some introduction to how to communicate and manage behaviors of people with dementia. We did turn out to have some money to provide services for clients. Most of it went to adult day or in-home care. We did provide some equipment we were able to purchase, and for one client, we purchased some mental health counseling for them. We did create the algorithm, which we're going to talk about, and the resource guide, which we'll also talk about in a few minutes, and we are almost done collecting the data. I still have 7 active clients. So we have all the pre-data from the quality of life and the CANE, but we haven't finished getting all the post-data. So Alzheimer's Greater Los Angeles and our chapters were partners on this first ACL grant. And so again, shortly after we started in San Francisco, our colleagues down in Los Angeles started their Live Alone project, but with some modification. They decided to partner with affordable housing. So they partnered with the B Group, which offers low-income housing. They have 20 HUD sites in LA. And the staff of Alzheimer's Greater Los Angeles really partnered with the service coordinators to help them identify the potential clients. And the thinking there was that the low-income seniors might be in more need of these services. So the framework for that program was they were going to train the B Group housing staff. And they were also going to offer educational workshops to the residents of the housing sites. And they did some case management, but they termed it case management light, where they only did about 2 to 3 home visits, whereas we would do up to 6. It really depended on the client. And because we were on the same ACL grant, we were using the same evaluation tools. So they're using the quality of life and the cane also. So these are the outcomes of their program. They had 21 referrals made to their program by the service coordinators. They enrolled 12 clients. One client went on to pursue a diagnosis. One client put legal and health-related plans in place. But they found the greatest need in LA, and when you think about LA, it probably makes a lot of sense, but the greatest need was transportation. So they ended up giving taxi vouchers to 8 of the clients. They did make referrals to some of these other services listed here, and they were able to reach 144 residents at the workshops that they offered at the housing sites. So that leads us to our third model, and this is back here in Northern California. So in San Mateo County, our Live Alone program was made possible by a voter-approved county sales tax that's dedicated in part to improving the lives of older adults. Yay, San Mateo County. We call it, yeah, that's the San Mateo County contingent back there. So we call this program the San Mateo County Dementia Capable Supports and Services Program, DCSS for short. So this program was led by our chapter and addressed the county priorities to keep older adults out of institutions and in their homes. So the activities of this project included building a coalition of dementia-capable organizations and county agencies to affect systems change. And we wanted to train and educate providers about dementia and its impact on people living alone. And we wanted to develop, deliver, and evaluate multidisciplinary services to meet the needs of these people living alone with dementia. And so this project, the DCSS, is mostly staffed by my colleague Rachel Cast, who's somewhere in the audience here today. So this is the framework for this program. We wanted to get 40 participants the first year. And the model, again, was case management, same as the San Francisco, up to six home visits, 6 to 12 months, in-person telephone support. We wanted to do the care circle development and education. But we wanted to also add a component of technology, where we want to try to incorporate some technology interventions. And these were high and low tech. I mean, some low tech ones were we partnered with a home safety assessment organization so that they could just, you know, put bathroom and kitchen safety stuff in. We have the Safe Return ID bracelet program. So that's low tech, but that's something that we're providing clients. And then some of the high tech or higher tech ones is, you know, stove guard for those folks that are still cooking. It's an alarm that monitors the stove so you can prevent a fire. Some memory aids like the dementia day clocks. If anyone hasn't seen it, it's amazing. It has the time, it says AM, PM, it has the date, the day of the week, and it's really helpful for keeping people oriented. We use some medication reminder clocks. And some new folks, we are trying out the Jerry Joy Care.coach iPad tablet remote monitoring companionship system. It's quite cool. and another technology intervention that we're actually considering is, or putting in place is San Mateo County didn't have a friendly visiting program, and so they're starting a friendly visiting program, and they're visiting our folks with dementia living alone. More clapping. So we're using the same evaluations tools, and again, there's a big systems level change focus here in San Mateo County. So this advisory council was created, and they meet monthly and have been very involved and been great with guiding the program. There's been a lot of educational workshops and trainings for county agencies and community organizations, and also to the general public. There's going to be, well, there was a dementia capability assessment that was done at the beginning of the program, and it will be done at the end to see if there's been any systems levels change from this program. And there's also going to be a process evaluation at the end of the project to see what worked, what didn't, and why it didn't work or why it did work. So these are the outcomes, and these are actually already out of date. It's been over 70 referrals have been made now, and I believe it was there's 43 clients enrolled, and 30 of those are still active cases for Rachel and Liliana. There were 81 community trainings reaching over 2,300 community members. And let's see, and so these are some of the services that were provided. So home care and adult day, also big ones. Personal emergency response systems, the stove guard, the bathroom assisted equipment. And again, three clients are now using this Jerry Joy companion system so that they have social interaction. So these are some of the lessons that we learned. The biggest one is this work's not easy, which we kind of expected. So one of the things we realized was it's still really hard to find these folks. They fly under the radar. So even with partners, it was hard to find folks. But the best thing about having these partners was there was already a trusting relationship between that member or client and the partners. So that made it really easy or easier for us to go in there and that person to trust me or Rachel or Liliana or Ivory. I found that for the San Francisco Dementia Safety Net program, actually everybody I worked with had what I would call somebody in their care circle. Sometimes it was an APS caseworker or an MSSP social worker. Sometimes it was the Meals on Wheels driver that came 5 days a week. And sometimes they had long distance families. Now the hard part was I wasn't always able to engage them more in the process, but we did try. We learned that our clients are fiercely independent and they don't want help, especially in their home. Memory impairment is definitely a threat to somebody's housing, whether it's their own home or in low-income senior housing or in a rental apartment. Not being able to take care of themselves or maybe having behavioral symptoms, it really threatens their stability, their housing stability. And so while a lot of folks didn't want any help in the home with their IADLs, what they really wanted was socialization. They didn't want to be isolated anymore. But they couldn't necessarily initiate that themselves. Our colleagues in Alzheimer's Greater LA figured out that the service coordinators can't do it all. These service coordinators in these housing sites, you know, there's usually only one of them per building. There's many residents, you know, 50 to 100 plus, and these service coordinators wear a lot of hats, even though case management is one of their hats. We also found there's definitely a need for the dementia-informed lens in assessing care. So knowing about dementia, knowing common dementia issues, and actually really knowing how to talk to somebody with dementia really makes the assessment easier and more effective. There's definitely a need for designated resources and innovative collaborative efforts. So not one program or service program or organization can do it all, and we don't want to recreate the wheel. So it really needs to be a multi-service agency effort. And then we found out that different populations had different needs. Those with higher incomes, sometimes they just needed guidance and care consultation. You know, they could choose from different types of care because they had some money. Now, they didn't always act on our guidance, but They had that guidance, and we gave it to them, and they had those options. The middle income, where most of our folks landed, they didn't have services available to them, and maybe they could purchase some, but not for the long term. And then folks at the Medi-Cal level, they do have programs available to them. You know, they have MSSP programs, case management programs, or IHSS that they can tap into. So now I'm going to tell you about how these programs and the lessons we've learned may relate to you and how you may be able to use some of these tools. So we developed an algorithm, and we call it the Live Alone algorithm. You'll see it in a minute. But we based it on a couple existing algorithms that were out there. So our chapter colleagues at Minnesota North Dakota, a couple years ago, they developed the community organization practice tool for their Act on All's dementia-friendly community toolkit. So that came out a couple years ago. And then UCSF has the geriatrics department has a community resources clinical algorithm that we also looked at and used parts of. And then we had our own little needs assessment survey that we tied into the algorithm. Now, we thought these existing items, they had aspects of what we wanted to do, but we felt that each had something missing, especially for those folks living alone. And there was actually an assumption of some caregiving help in all these algorithms, and our folks are living alone. So the result, we developed our Live Alone Dementia Safety Net algorithm, and we think this algorithm assesses a person's safety. It helps them get the appropriate diagnosis. It assesses their needs and wants, and then conveniently lists a number of services and programs that these folks can be connected to. And I know this is terrible to see on the screen. You do have the algorithm in your handouts. It's the end of my slides. And then I actually have some that I will be putting out on our table over here that are printed a little bit larger and on cardstock if you want to take them home. But so it's a two-page document. On the first page is what we call the decision tree, and then on the back side is what are called the intervention options, and this is the list of available programs and services that you might be able to consider for somebody you're working with. So our short-term goal for this algorithm was to have the Alzheimer's Association staff nationwide be able to use it to assess and address the needs of these folks living alone. Longer term, we want to modify it some, make it a little bit simpler for the layperson, for community organizations, because this one's a little bit clinical, and I'll point out those clinical pieces. We also tried to make it general enough that it can be used throughout the nation, but we also wanted it specific enough to really point out those dementia support services that would be useful. And because we are in the heart of Silicon Valley, we are now developing this into an app that you conveniently use on your phone or iTablet kind of thing. So this is the backside. This is the intervention options. Again, I know it doesn't show up well here, but you can see it in your packet. So this is the list of community resources and services that are available in most counties. So there are a couple unique points that I wanted to point out here. So we had a unique definition of live alone. So we define live alone as someone living alone or somebody living with somebody else, but that person doesn't provide enough adequate care. And this came out because we had a referral from a housing site where the woman had her son living with her in her apartment, but he would disappear for days at a time. And she was definitely middle stages. So we wanted to work with her and try to work with him. So that's why we expanded the definition of not just somebody who's only living alone. We integrated a safety assessment into the algorithm. It's one of the first things that you see. It's the red stop sign. We'll see in a second. So for those people who are familiar with APS reporting requirements, you know, we advise that you do an APS referral if the person meets those mandated reporting requirements. But for folks who might not be quite so familiar with those requirements, we put in this Live Alone assessment from the University of Iowa, and it helps guide a decision. And I have copies of that. I'll put on the table, too. And then the last thing that we did is there's a footnote that the person has the right of refusal. So they could decline not to be part of our program, or they could refuse or discontinue to being part of the program whenever they wanted. And we wanted to respect their right to self-determination for that. So we did decide, though, if that happened, we would want, again, to make sure that the person is safe and if they needed an APS referral or not. So this is how you're going to use the algorithm. So there's two starting points. There's a starting box if the person has a diagnosis of some form of dementia. There's a starting box if the person shows or is exhibiting signs of dementia or cognitive impairment. And we put that latter path in there, for again, for more like community agencies. I used to work at a senior center, and I mean, people come into a senior center and you see them over years, over time, and things change. So you might be able to get a sense of what's going on with them. Again, there's the built-in safety check, this Live Alone, Iowa Live Alone assessment. And it's broken down into several columns. There are certain criteria which would require immediate attention, and then there's other criteria where like two or three have to be noticeable before you'd want to have immediate intervention. So the easiest path is this one if they have a diagnosis. You meet with them, you assess their needs, you create a care plan, you make referrals if you need to, or help facilitate the referrals if they're able to follow through, and then you decide when you want to follow up with them. So that's this path here, if I can get my animation to work. So this is the starting box if a person has a diagnosis. Then you do this immediate safety check, this red stop sign. So this is look for APS mandated reporting requirements or use the Iowa Live Alone assessment to see if they need immediate assistance. And if everything is good there, you skip down to the bottom box. Oops, I knew that was going to happen. The bottom box here, and this is basically the care planning piece. This is all those categories on the back side that you would go over with them and see where they needed help. And so one thing that I learned over time is I started not bringing in paper and pen to these meetings with folks. It was very conversational. They did not like me sitting there taking notes or checking off boxes. So sometimes it took two or three home visits in about a 3-week, 1-month period to really have the conversation to figure out what might be best for them. So then if they don't have a diagnosis, there's a path you can use. You can do a cognitive screen, and we include the mini-cog and the AD8 for that. The AD8 is an informant tool. And you can provide resources if they have a positive or negative screen for cognitive impairment. You assess their safety, and you can create a care plan, or you can refer to APS if necessary. So that's this path on the algorithm. So you start at the top box. This means they don't have a diagnosis. Maybe they're exhibiting signs of cognitive impairment or dementia. Again, you do that initial safety check, and you provide immediate assistance or an APS referral, whichever is appropriate. If everything is good there, you can do a mini-cog if you get their permission, or use the AD8 based on your observations of them. The AD8 is 8 questions about changes that might have happened in the person. And then depending on the results, you'd go one of two routes. So if the screen shows no indication of cognitive impairment, we provided the people with brain health and healthy aging information. We have pamphlets on that. And so we would just leave them with that kind of information. If there was indication of cognitive impairment, which would be a score of less than 4 on a mini-cog and greater than 2 on the AD8, we would encourage them to see their primary care doctor and tell them about this screen, or make a referral to one of the diagnostic centers that we have in this area. And for these folks that fell into this bucket, I didn't necessarily just tell them to go talk to their doctor and then call me later. I actually sometimes with them started doing some care planning and assessing. Now hopefully, after some time, they actually will have seen their doctor and maybe you have a clearer picture. And again, if they don't have any sort of memory impairment, cognitive impairment, you can provide them with brain health material. But if they did, If they did, then you would go and you would do the care planning piece with them. You know, figure out what they want and need and put together those referrals and help them make those connections. Now the middle path gets a little bit more complicated. And this is if they refuse the referral. So you want to determine if they're safe and supported. And if they're safe and supported, there are no reportable issues, you can provide educational material on dementia and leave your contact information and go on your way. This happened with one person that we met with. She was a retired physician. And she gave me permission to do the mini-cog, and I don't remember, I think she had a score of 2. But she didn't want to talk to her doctor. She said, I'm a retired physician. I just changed doctors. I don't really like this doctor. I don't really trust her yet. So we had long conversations with her, and we ended up making a plan where she was actually still very good friends with her former doctor, so she said she was going to talk to that doctor. But we were there for about an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours, and in that time, a neighbor stopped by. Her phone rang 3 times. And it announced who was calling, and it was all people known to her. And she actually at that time had some in-home caregiving help because she had just come out of the hospital for pneumonia. So the partner I was with there, we decided she's safe and supported. She has family that also checked on her a lot. And plus now my partner, and this was with San Francisco Village, they were very much aware of what was going on. And this woman was coming to San Francisco Village events. So now San Francisco Village knows what's going on too. It was another set of eyes on her. So if you determine that they're not safe and supported, APS referral is likely appropriate. So we use the mini-cog. I didn't use the 88 in any situations. Folks were fine with me doing the mini-cog. But the 88, again, it's a good informant tool, so it can be used by somebody who knows the person. And for folks that maybe feel that they're not as clinical, it's actually a really easy tool to use, more comfortable tool to use. So now I'm going to give you a case study, and in the next slide, we'll walk her through the algorithm. And this is pretty similar to one of the people I worked with, an 80-year-old female, and she did have a diagnosis of dementia. She was referred to me by her physician, and when I met with her in person, her clothes were a little dirty and her apartment was a little bit messy, but the floor was clean, didn't have just pads. I mean, it was truly clean. She did have some newspapers and papers kind of that cluttered on tabletops, especially around the stove. That worried me a little bit. She told me that she would walk to the store to buy her food, but there wasn't a ton in the fridge or pantry, but there was food. She told me that she had a daughter who lived in another state and who calls, and she was on Medi-Cal. So we're going to walk this client through the algorithm, and while we're doing that, I want you to also think about, what kind of services could be in the initial care plan, and then think about who you might be able to identify as a potential care circle for this gal. So again, we're gonna call her Mrs. L. She's 80 years old. She's in a rent-controlled apartment that she's been in for 37 years, which is pretty common in San Francisco. She was referred by her doctor, and she had a diagnosis of dementia. She was definitely impaired in her IADLs, the cleaning piece. There was clutter on the tabletops, countertops, but again, floor was clean. She was dressed appropriately enough, but it did look like her clothes could use a little bit more laundering than it was getting. She did have food in the pantry and the fridge. She said she did limited cooking, mostly warming food in the microwave. And her trips to the store were the local Trader Joe's, which was about 6 or 7 blocks from her house. Grooming, she looked pretty good. She mentioned she used to have somebody come help her out, and so I was thinking that she probably did at some point have an IHSS worker, but she said that the person just stopped coming. And then she did tell you that there's a daughter, and she gave me permission to talk to the daughter and gave me the phone number. And the one thing I couldn't get her to do is she couldn't focus, and so I was asking her to get her Medi-Cal number so I could see if I could contact IHSS to see if she was having IHSS services. And by the time she got to her purse, she forgot what she was looking for. And then as she started pulling things out of her purse, she got distracted by everything in her purse. She was a lovely woman, though. Oh, here I was going to walk you through the path. There was no immediate safety concerns, so we jumped down to assessing what she needed, and then trying to get the information to talk to the daughter. So these are just some areas that I thought were areas of discussion with her. So obviously daily living and functioning were a big area for her, right? Cleaning, meal prepping and cooking, laundry, maybe even transportation, because you know she said she walked down to Trader Joe's, but how long is she gonna be able to do that? There were some safety concerns, like she's walking to the store. Is she gonna get confused someday, get lost? Those papers near the stove were a concern of mine, even though she said she didn't do a lot of cooking. Because she's Medi-Cal, there's the potential to refer to MSSP if she hadn't already been referred. And then since she gave me permission to talk to her daughter, I did end up calling and talking to the daughter for further information. So these were some of the possible care plan services that we discussed. So legally, for legal, you know, was there an identified power of attorney? And it turned out it was the daughter. And the daughter lived out of state, but the daughter was managing mom's money, paying her bills, paying her rent. Referring to MSSP, the case management program of San Francisco, is a big service that would be helpful. Reconnecting her to IHSS, she did have an IHSS worker. The daughter said, yeah, the person stopped coming. I figured it was just because she's not being paid very much, and the daughter didn't really follow through on it. Now, in San Francisco, IHSS has a great program. It's a small portion of their IHSS program. It's called Homebridge, and it's where Homebridge actually manages the IHS worker for the client, for the clients that can't manage it. And this is fantastic for folks with dementia, right? Person with dementia who's living alone isn't going to be able to manage their own IHSS worker. When they don't show up anymore, they're not going to be able to call IHSS and say, okay, I need a new worker. I don't think every county has that program, though. I would suggest getting the Safe Return bracelet for her. It's low tech, but if she's still out going out walking to Trader Joe's, she's going to get lost at some point. At least she'll have the ID bracelet. Consider getting a stove guard for her, but if we could get an IHSS worker back in there to do the meal prep or the cooking for her and clear off the clutter near the stove, you know, maybe that's not necessary, but it's an option. Another option is also to bring in Meals on Wheels, because in San Francisco, one of the plans is you can have a warm delivered meal, so she wouldn't have to worry about cooking. And then I always think having paratransit on board just as a backup is a good thing to have, so doing the paratransit application. So now for the potential care circle, well, obviously the daughter's involved, and now I'm connected to the daughter, and now I am eyes and ears closer to mom than the daughter is. Now, obviously, also the doctor is part of this care circle, because the doctor referred her, so it's good for me to get permission from the client to talk to the doctor so the doctor knows what's going on. And then if we can get her some sort of case management program, or if we get her into Meals on Wheels, the Meals on Wheels delivery driver 5 days a week is a set of eyes. And one of my clients, it was the Meals on Wheels driver or delivery person, when she didn't answer the door, contacted the emergency contact, which was an MSSP case manager, who notified the building manager, who went to the apartment and found out she had fallen. And it was because of that delivery that we knew that she was down, and they got her to the hospital. So you could also consider a friendly visitor program for her. San Francisco, well, actually nationwide, there's the friendship line for daily calls. Possibly suggest an adult day program. There's just a lot of things you can consider over time. So as I mentioned, we're developing this into an app. So the algorithms in there, the Care Circle Research Guide, which I'll tell you about in a second, is incorporated in there. So we have a general version, and we have a specific version for San Mateo County, because again, these Measure K funds are funding this app. So in the San Mateo version, we've got a listing and direct connections, hyperlinks to San Mateo specific programs and services. It's really, it's kind of cool. It's interactive. You can actually do, you can do the 88 on there. You can't do the mini cog, but it actually shows you how to do the mini cog. And then you can email the results to yourself or to other people. There's a ton of fact sheets on the app. So fact sheets on the different dementias, behavior management, communication, services. There's just a ton of information on there. And again, it's being funded by the Measure K funds. So another deliverable of the program is what we call our Care Circle Resource Guide. And there's 14 tips in this resource guide. And let's see. You probably can't read it very well here, but this is the table of contents with the titles of the 14 tips. There's also a technology resource guide that we've put together because technology is a big piece of this program. And there's a chart on what the different kind of care, long-term care options are. And then there's community resource listings. We have our different programs for the Alzheimer's Association, the different programs that Alzheimer's Greater Los Angeles has. We also have a general version of this Care Circle Resource Guide. We also have it in Spanish. I've got a few Spanish ones. We have about 100 of these guides that we'll put on our table at the break. We have about 10 in Spanish. We have the San Mateo specific ones. We also have general ones. So if you want to grab one, you can. Again, this is all getting incorporated into the app also. Come on. Oh, that's what it's doing. It was doing I forgot about the little, I got all high-techy and put in these animations here. So these are just some screenshots of some of the different pages. So the technology resource guide. Now I've gone too far, the resources. Anyway, so our next step. So we still have Measure K funding. And we're expanding now into more community-based organizations. In San Francisco, we got another administrative ACL grant, and we're moving into low-income housing now. We're gonna work with the RAD housing, which is Rental Assistance Demonstration Housing. And this is a program in San Francisco where public housing is being, San Francisco Public Housing, San Francisco used to own these buildings, and they're transferring the ownership to different private organizations like NCPHS and Mercy and Bridge Housing. And so they're going to take these buildings on. So we're working with them and their service coordinators to identify folks and help them out. We're going to modify the algorithm to make it a little bit easier for the layperson, for community-based organizations. And then we're looking to share these tools with the general public through the dementia-friendly community and the dementia-friendly movement that is gaining traction throughout our area. So I do want to acknowledge that we have these two grants. Well, the first, the original grant, now a new one from the Administration for Community Living. And again, San Mateo County Measure K funds have been invaluable to these programs. I want to thank our partners, Alzheimer's Greater LA, Little Brothers Friends of the Elderly, Open House San Francisco Village, and then the San Mateo DCSS Advisory Coalition. And then I have to really thank my colleagues. Rachel Cast, again, has been the lead in San Mateo County, but Liliana Kashuba has been helping in San Mateo and San Francisco with Spanish clients, which we've had about 11 in San Mateo and 2 in San Francisco. And then Ivory Yang has been helping me in San Francisco with Chinese-speaking clients. So we really couldn't do it without them. So again, I'm gonna have the algorithms and the resource guides on our table during the break, but if there are any questions, do I have time for questions? I have 3 minutes. Yeah, I think there's gonna be a microphone coming around. Oh, sorry, the question was, if the woman has some money, but not Medi-Cal eligible, maybe only like 50 or 80,000, how do you go about the care plan? Kind of depends on the county. In San Francisco, we had limited funds where we could provide some services at first. San Mateo County, we actually, because of these Measure K funds, we can actually provide a lot more services that we can pay for. But we still don't have a perfect answer for that, because 50,000 isn't going to go super far. Yeah. Tom.
Yeah, hi. Listen, thanks very much for your presentation. I'm really glad your staff are going into those buildings that's in San Francisco. That's great. Listen, I just want to make sure that people who work in San Francisco are also aware of a fairly extensive case management service through the Department of Aging and Adult Services that contracts out with probably 6 or 8 mm-hmm. private nonprofits that have some Department of Public Health assistance, and that's 355-6700 is their central intake line. Working primarily with seniors. And another really good excellent case management program is through the Department of Public Health. It's called the Emergency Department Case Management out of San Francisco General. Huh. 3 hospitalizations in a year or 5 emergency room visits in a year gets very intensive case management with folks that have very low caseloads. It's a great, great program.
Thank you. I didn't know about that one. I had several clients who had case management through DOS, through the agencies. Yeah, they've been a wonderful partner. That's it? Okay. Sorry, that's it. I will have materials up at our table in a few minutes. Thank you.